Coming up on Theater Talk.
In a record-breaking sixth win.
Audra McDonald.
It is going to be Audra McDonald.
And if she wins this, Michael, that means that she's the only actress to have won.
In all four acting categories.
Right, supporting
lead,
actress,
supporting,
in
drama,
play.
And musical.
Plus, she won for lighting design one.
best set. She was best set.
Theater Talk is made possible in part by the CUNY TV Foundation. From New York City, this is Theater Talk. I'm Susan Haskins.
And I'm Michael Riedel of the New York Post.
And Michael, what a year. It's Tony predictions time.
Yes, absolutely. And all the races are really kind of wide open. There are no clear-cut favorites. So there's a lot of tension around Broadway this time of year. And here to play on that tension, to stick the poker and swirl everything up and stir the pot and drive everybody who's hoping for a little Tony Award crazy, we have three of the most evil people on the planet. Patrick Pacheco of New York One on stage, the Los Angeles Times, and artinfo.com. Welcome to Theater Talk, Patrick. Michael Musto of out.com wearing... Now, that outfit reminds me of those cartoon characters who sing supercalifragilistic in Mary Poppins.
This is actually a dish rag from Aladdin. Okay.
And finally, we're joined by the rather sedately dressed... Critic of the panel, Mr. Jesse Green of New York Magazine.
Thank you. I've become serious recently. I actually signed a W-2 form, so don't make fun of me anymore.
Wow, you're no longer in the freelance world.
I have flown up like the brownies, if you even know what that means.
I have no idea. All right, gentlemen, you are here to give us your fearless and always accurate, except in the case of Mr. Pacheco, predictions for this year's Tony Award winners. So let's begin with the most important category of all. Best Musical, Susan, the nominees are...
Best Musical, After Midnight, Aladdin, Beautiful, the Carole King Musical, A Gentleman's Guide to Love and Murder.
All right, Patrick, what's your favorite here?
I think you can go anyway, and I think whoever mounts the best campaign can probably take it over the finish line.
And what would a campaign consist of this year, would you say?
I think they just work the road vote, because that... constitutes about 100 votes right there.
And we should say the road vote are the people who present shows across the country, and they tend to vote for shows that are going to play in their markets.
Absolutely. I think since they cut us out, which was another, the press that is, the first night press list, which is another 80 voting block, I think that it's changed the game. And I think these are also evenly divided, that any one of these four
well,
could
I'm
actually
gonna,
take it.
So, come on, you're here to predict.
Beautiful.
Beautiful, the Carole King musical.
Beautiful, yeah. Why? I think that's, I think, number one, they enjoy it the most. It's probably the best crafted of many of them, perhaps.
Sorry, I'm having the vapors over here.
I think it's got a passably good book by Doug McGrath. I think it features a terrific performance by Jesse Mueller. I think the Carole King songbook is very popular. Mm-hmm. I think it kind of delivers on those. I wouldn't put it past After Midnight getting it either.
Mm. All right, so you hate Beautiful, Jesse, apparently.
Well, that's a little too strong, but to say it's, you know, among the better crafted of these musicals.
I think it's up there with My Fair Lady, frankly. I love that. I love Beautiful, the Carole King musical.
My Fair Lady, the Carole King songbook. Yeah, I agree that it could go any way. And what's really interesting is these four choices, and there were other, I think, good musicals as well that could have been in the category, are very different kinds of music. I really think it's going to be a close race because it's going to divide up the voters among those who like a pure entertainment review versus a book musical versus an animated. Well, does anyone really prefer an animated cartoon? But anyway.
You've got kids.
There's a different, they're 20 and 18.
No.
There's a different kind of musical for each kind of audience, which is great for Broadway, but maybe hard for the Tonys.
Michael,
what's
going
to win?
Left out of these nominees was your favorite, Bullets Over Broadway, which is a musical about foul foods.
That was my favorite musical until I actually saw it, and then
yes.
I had to change my
tune. The only show you saw.
A little bit.
But it's a musical about phallic food, from dancing hot dogs to singing bananas.
I know.
And it was shiny and beautiful, great production.
You liked it, Bullets
No, Broadway? Beautiful production, but yeah. It's like a beautiful package that you open, and out comes the fist from Rocky. there wasn't a lot of introspection in there.
No.
Gentleman's Guide is the only one of the four nominees to have all original music. How shocking
yes,
is that?
Yeah.
We have a Disney show with some original music, we have a review, and we have a songbook.
But it's interesting that the Tony nominators shut out all the original musicals except...
Because they weren't very good.
No, I think a case could be made for something.
But shut out all the original musicals except
Gentleman's Guide.
Well, I think Gentleman's
Guide is going to win because it's original. Yeah. However, I think there is more passion for Beautiful. And they had the brilliant PR thing of Carole King couldn't see it. It was too painful because
I
can't watch yourself have a divorce and then triumph and win the Grammy. You know, but then she could
see it. That was my narrative. I played that narrative out for them.
Then she summoned up the courage and they made money for AIDS.
But they tried that with Aladdin, too. They were going to have Walt Disney come on stage finally. But the defroster didn't
defroster.
Work.
All right, so I need predictions, though. Jesse, it's going
to
be...
I'm going to guess that it's going to be Gentleman's Guide.
Same here.
Beautiful.
Susan?
Gentleman's Guide, but I don't. I'm on the.
Easy. I think it's an easy category. It's going to be beautiful. No question.
Because of the road vote.
The road vote. Yeah. That is 100 votes solid going right into Tony Knight with that. And there are a lot more people who are going to make a lot more money.
And when it was Newsies against Once, what did you say?
Newsies.
And I said.
No, Once. I said Once.
I said Once.
And when it was Matilda against Kinky Boots, what did
I said,
you say?
I said Kinky Boots. No, it's gonna be Carole King, the musical. It's making over $1 million a week. Gentleman's Guide to Love and Murder, which is a sweet, charming show, though I haven't seen it yet. But
it's a sweet, charming show.
It's not a hit, you know. And the Tony voters will never vote for something that's not a hit. The thing about Once that year too, Once was a hit. It was doing well, but Gentleman's Guide not. So it's gonna be beautiful. Best Play, Susan. The nominees are
Act One.
I don't sit. I pace.
All the Way.
This is about votes.
Casa Valentina.
Why invite in the snakes?
Mothers and Sons.
Andre wasn't gay when he came to New York.
Outside Mullingar.
Does it ever seem to you that this country is just too small?
Well, maybe you should emigrate.
Michael, what are you leaning for in this one? Casa Valentina because, or Mothers and Sons? Because you're an openly gay man and these are openly gay plays.
Act One is about Moss Hart. That's pretty gay.
Yeah, that's
even if they don't go there. Act One is also about the theater, and theater people love that kind of self-congratulatory thing about the making of a play. It had the worst pre-buzz of any show this year, and then opened to like, hey, it's not bad.
Well, it was very long in previews. Act One of like 3 hours, but James Lapine managed to.
I still think it's going to be All the Way because that has the feeling of importance. Mm. It's long. People love something.
And that's the play about Lyndon Johnson's first year in office. Yeah. So you think it's All the Way, Patrick?
I agree. I think it's probably going to be All the Way. It has that heft. It has that historical heft as well. And I think it was very well done. And I think Bryan Cranston's going to take it as best actor in a lead.
Jesse, did you like All the Way?
Pretty well. Certainly a lot more than Act One. I didn't realize that's what the critics say. I no longer read the critics.
I don't blame you.
Even my own. All the Way is exactly the kind of play that the Tony voters tend to award, and it is well done. And
now, is it going to bother anybody that All the Way is really inaccurate? Historically,
who are you, Doris Kearns Goodwin?
No, but I mean, that's my only quibble about it.
The answer is no.
It's a bunch of Tony voters.
What about
you think they're experts in 20th century American history?
Talking about Beautiful, the Carole King musical.
Well, that's true.
If accuracy were any guide to Love or Murder or Tony Awards,
but Beautiful, the musical, which I had my problems with the book because I felt it was like a 50s biopic that was very inaccurate. But when you're dealing with history that way, it just seems it's a great performance.
Substantiate the charge.
Number one, they conflate his negotiations with the 1957 Civil Rights Bill with the 1964 Civil Rights Bill, and a lot of facts that should be in the one or in the other.
Is electrifying television.
The Tony voters don't care about accuracy.
All right, thank you.
Exactly. I actually think it's going to be. Act One, because I think, as Michael said, theater people are sentimental, not about this play, about that book, and they do like that self-congratulatory, we're all in this crazy business together, just trying to put on a good show. So I give it to Act One, you give it to All the Way.
I give it to All the Way.
All the Way?
All the Way.
You hate All the Way, right?
No, I don't hate All the Way. I think it will win.
I'm the only person here for Act One.
Cheese
stands alone.
Which you haven't seen. Thank you very much.
All right, best revival of a musical. The nominees, Susan, are?
Hedwig and the Angry Inch. Les Miserables. Violet.
You gotta let it see.
I think this is Hedwig and the Angry Inch, is it not, Patrick? Easily?
I think it's as close to a lock as you can get. Of any of these Tony nominations, that Hedwig will be honored. I think Michael Mayer will, in
who directed
director,
it,
and also Neil Patrick Harris.
As the
I think he's going to have a very good night.
Let me ask you guys though. I saw the original production of Hedwig when it was down at the Jane Street Playhouse, and I thought it was very, very moving. And you really got a sense. John Cameron Mitchell, who played Hedwig originally, really was a sad, pathetic, broken down act there.
Mm-hmm.
I thought this was a very superficial, very glossy, Broadwayized version of the show, and I did not think for a moment that Neil Patrick Harris was a broken down old rock glam rock star.
I liked it a lot, but a lot of people are finding that the inch perhaps isn't angry enough. Neil Patrick Harris, and I guess people with three names have to play this part for some reason, he has given interviews where he talked about
James Earl Jones is going to draw a room.
Yeah, and Kathy Lee Gifford. And, Neil has said that he did research to become comfortable in Hedwig's skin, but Hedwig should not be comfortable in her skin. She's the victim of a botched operation. Yeah. And John Cameron Mitchell told me Hedwig doesn't speak for the trans community. She's trans by not by choice.
Right, right.
Or what I said that wrong. But you know what I'm saying.
But he said something, and it was insightful.
Right, right, right.
However, I thought it was sensational, and the way he leaped into the role was daring and exciting, and the way they transformed it for a Broadway stage, and they made it, oh, this is going to be on the set of the abandoned musical about Hurt Locker.
A little strange.
A bit of a stretch?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You seem a little skeptical about it.
Well, I think that they had to do something to make it fit on a Broadway stage, and the different interpretation goes along with the different venue. I saw the original as well, both with John Cameron Mitchell and Michael Cerveris, who followed him, and it was a very different show. It was more pathetic.
Yeah.
It was...
just more emotionally...
Hedwig didn't have control over her image or her pathos. This Hedwig is playing that shtick for the entertainment of the audience. I don't think that's a terrible choice. It probably is necessary in order to sell that number of seats in that kind of place. I think it was probably a pretty smart choice.
But you could have done anything then with Neil Patrick Harris. I mean, the thing was, he was just, I'm Neil Patrick Harris, I'm going to tell these shticky jokes and run around in bizarro wigs. And that could have been any show, not this one about this tormented person that I had previously.
But apparently the time was right because it is doing
it.
Very well.
One thing I do want to say, though, of all of the scores out there, I still think Hedwig is the best score, one of the few genuine rock scores that works also as a musical theater score.
It's a great score, but Violet is a great score, too, and I would love to see it recognized in some category or another. I'm not sure if it will be.
So Hedwig, you think?
I think so.
Hedwig.
And I love Lena Hall in Hedwig, I have to say.
Oh, yeah, she's very good. A revival of a play. The nominees, Susan, are?
The Cripple of Inishman.
Poor Billy'll never be getting kissed unless it was be a blind girl.
The Glass Menagerie.
Oh. Here you are in the Pirates of Penzance.
A Raisin in the Sun.
Man say I got me a dream. Woman say eat your egg.
Twelfth Night.
How now, Malvoli? Oh.
Jesse, I thought for a while it would be Raising the Sun, but I'm hearing more and more Twelfth Night. People seem to remember that very fine Mark Rylance production that is now closed, but it was very successful. And I think there's some affection for that still.
It was a unique Broadway event. It was beautifully produced. And although A Raisin in the Sun and, for that matter, The Glass Menagerie were excellent revivals of those shows, we get revivals like that from time to time. We do not get things like Twelfth Night very often, let alone successfully. So I think it could be that people are turning toward it for that reason, but really any of these would be a viable candidate.
Yeah, Michael, your defense?
Cripple doesn't have a leg to stand on.
Oh, God. Were you up all night working on that one?
2 weeks. Raisin was superb, but its chances are shriveling in the sun, and Glass Menagerie's chances are shattered. That leaves Twelfth Night. A Glass Menagerie I liked and a lot of people went insane for, but it's really divided people. Some people thought it shouldn't be about a woman who really wants the best for her kids. It should be about a monster, because that's how they're used to seeing it.
Right, right.
Twelfth Night I thought was extraordinary. It was an astonishing production, and this is the year of drag and trans on Broadway. Three of the performances in this that are nominated are from drag out of seven cross-dress performances, let's say.
Boy, you're really tripping up on all this gender-bending stuff. This is not an area where you should go very often. I'm very confused. Patrick, it's Raisin. I think it's between Raisin the Sun and Twelfth Night.
I think it's Twelfth Night. I think people just have really fond memories of Twelfth Night. And I think they'll remember them when it comes to voting. I think it's Twelfth Night.
Yeah, I'm a big Raisin the Sun fan. I think this is a wonderful production. I think it's a great play. But more and more I'm hearing Twelfth Night.
Twelfth Night, yeah.
And you got a pre-show with Twelfth Night. Yeah. You got to watch them getting ready. It was sort of like
playing
Mama
the mandolin.
Mia. It was like Mamma Mia.
Right. All right, let's get to some of the performers there, Susan. Best performance by a leading actress in a musical.
Mary Bridget Davis, A Night with Janis Joplin. Sutton Foster, Violet. Idina Menzel, If Then. Jesse Mueller, Beautiful, the Carole King musical. Kelly O'Hara, The Bridges of Madison County.
So it's quite a lineup there, Jesse. Where do you think the voters are going to
I really don't know. I'm not just playing a game. They were all excellent. These are all deserving performances. And I think, you know, If Then was not received in general as well, although I liked it. I seem to have been the only critic who did. So that might work against Idina Menzel. Kelly O'Hara has never won a Tony, is performing as well as she has ever performed in her whole life, and is singing the most beautiful music beautifully. So some people may feel it's time, but Jesse Mueller seems to be a popular favorite at this point.
So you think it's going to be Jesse Mueller if you had to tip your hat?
I guess so.
All right, Michael?
Seems to me they didn't cotton to Michelle Williams in Cabaret.
They
purposely
did not.
Omitted her, and yeah. they went
she
back.
She was the biggest star of them all in this category. Well, I guess Adina's a big star now.
Jesse Mueller shot out like a cannonball when she did On a Clear Day. She was the rising star of that production. She has not stopped working ever since. People adore her as Carole King. There's the passion element. Mm-hmm. And I think it's her chance to be anointed.
Jesse Mueller. Patrick?
I just don't know. I mean, it's just such a tough category. But I think
we don't have you on the show not to know. You're supposed to be an expert.
Okay. Jesse Mueller.
Okay.
Jesse Mueller. But I agree with Jesse that If Then. No, Jesse Green.
Jesse Mueller thinks Kelly's going to win.
If Then deserved a lot more respect than it got or received from the Tony.
I think it's going to be Jesse Mueller, and what I admired most about her performance is that it's not really a Broadway
performance. This was the third time you've said this on the show. I'm sorry. This exact monologue you're about to give, you've said twice before on the show.
Well, that's because it's insightful and worth repeating. I think Jesse Mueller it's not a flashy, big Broadway performance. I think it's very subtle and ultimately quite moving. I know the only kind of acting Susan respects is Ethel Merman.
Just want to put in a word. Sutton Foster is giving the best performance of her career too.
Yes.
In a totally unglamorous way, which Tony voters sometimes enjoy. So I don't think she has the momentum that we've been talking about for Jesse Mueller, but still.
And Kelly O'Hara has had 5 nominations and never won. Is this her fifth? I think it's her fifth.
Countless.
All right. Best performance by a leading actress in a play, Susan. The nominees are?
Best performance by a leading actress in a play, Tyne Daly, Mothers and Sons. LaTanya Richardson Jackson, A Raisin in the Sun. Cherry Jones, The Glass Menagerie. Audra McDonald, Lady Day at Emerson's Bar and Grill. Estelle Parsons, The Velocity of Autumn.
I think Estelle only performed that play 3 times, was that? Because she got sick and then the play closed.
Well, no. The play was quite successful out of town. It came in
well, I know, but actually on Broadway, it didn't last
long. No.
It closed in 3 hours.
I saw Estelle but the day she came back from being out for 6 performances because she'd been sick. And what a life force that woman has on stage. It was just amazing.
She's a wonderful actress, no question about it, but
nobody
saw
it. Yeah.
Nobody
it was
saw
a
it.
Horrible play. You cannot really win that award.
That's
in a horrible
problem,
play.
All right, who's it going to be, Patrick?
Those four other performances are incredible. Yeah. All of them.
Yeah.
You know, in any other season, LaTanya Richardson Jackson would win
She's remarkable in A Raisin in the Sun.
Walk.
Wonderful, yeah.
But I think it's going to be in a record-breaking 6th win.
Audra McDonald.
It is going to be Audra McDonald.
And if she wins this, Michael, that means that she's the only actress to have won
in all 4 acting categories.
Right, supporting
Lead,
actress,
supporting
in
drama,
play.
And musical.
Plus, she won for lighting design one.
And best set. She was best set. I think it's unfair, Susan and Michael, that Cherry Jones, for one person, has to compete with somebody who sings literally 16 songs. How do you compete with that? Audra should be in the musical category. I don't care if it's, you think it's a play with music, it's a musical.
No, you're right. And the strength of her performance was in that uncanny vocal performance with Billie Holiday, not in the acting part of that sort of not very interesting play. It was the amazing singing. And so,
well, I would argue that
she was extraordinary. And I think whatever category she would be in, she would win. So I think she's going to win this one. Though LaTanya would be a wonderful choice. Not only did she have to come in as a replacement for Diane Carroll at the last minute and
help save
a monumental role, she did a brilliant job.
Yeah, I mean, I would give it to LaTanya Jackson if I were a voter, but I do think Audra McDonald's going to win. I think there's sentiment for her to break a record, set a record.
as I am now committed to in print, it was one of the greatest performances I've ever seen. So.
Well, Angela Lansbury, who's got five, is going, come on, LaTanya.
Who do you think it's going to be, Susan?
I haven't the slightest idea, frankly.
All right.
Who would you vote for, Susan?
Estelle Parsons.
Yes.
She's the only person in Broadway who saw the performance.
Just for old lang syne. No, but everybody was so great.
And where's Miss Machinal?
Rebecca Hall.
Oh, she was
brilliant.
Excellent. Yeah.
She was excellent. Brilliant.
All right, we only have a few minutes left, so let's just touch on a couple of other things. Score, the original score for a musical, They Are, Susan?
Aladdin. Bridges of Madison County. A Gentleman's Guide.
Oh, I don't understand the poor.
If Best. So here
I go. Patrick, who's going to get original score this year?
I think it's going to be Jason Robert Brown.
For Madison County?
For Madison County. Yeah, it's a gorgeous score. It's been a good year for scores.
Do you remember the time when he won the score for Parade?
Famously, Michael.
Tell that story.
Classic.
Tell
classic.
That story.
We were in the press room when he won the best score, Tony, for...
Parade.
Parade.
Yeah.
And we were in the press room, and I was sitting next to Michael, who, of course, as he said it at the beginning of this broadcast, he was just stirring the pot. And Michael said what everybody else in the room was thinking, which was, it wasn't a very competitive year. Yeah. So Michael, of course, had to enunciate the id and said to Jason Robert Brown, there's a feeling in this room, collectively drawing us all in, that there wasn't much competition, and you really just won out of default. And Jason Robert Brown said something like, I've worked very hard for this. A lot of people have worked very hard for this. And a little blankety blank blank like you isn't about to take it away from me.
I'm going to be in the press room and I'm going to ask him again this year if he won by default. Who do you think is going to get scored?
I think Jason Cameron Mitchell once again. three names. The opening song I thought was ghastly, and when the ex-wife, you didn't see it, but the ex-wife floats out and sings some guitar song as the other two are cooking dinner or something, I thought that was terrible. But a lot of the music is beautiful, even though it's of the I love you, no I love you kind of variety.
Ugh, God.
But it's a not very competitive year, let's
face it. Does your favorite If Then have a chance?
I don't think so. I do like the score quite a lot. I'm the only one, once again, but I think Jason Robert Brown will win it. I disagree with your characterization of those songs, especially the song The Wife Sings, which is a Joni Mitchell song Joni Mitchell wishes she could have written. And I hope he wins just so he can say the same thing to you this year.
Thank you very much. Yeah, okay. You know, if I were a voter, I'd give it to Aladdin, because to me, that's the most tuneful of them all.
It's based on the new original songs that they wrote. Do you understand that?
No.
You're factoring in the hits from the...
I like the hits.
A Gentleman's Guide has no chance?
Probably not. It's
if it's swept, I think. If you're looking to win the best musical, then it's quite likely that it wins best score.
There.
If it wins best musical.
Sing me a song from Gentleman's Guide.
I've decided to marry you. I've decided to marry you.
It's better with a man.
I'm sorry.
Harvey Fierstein's theme.
All right, we only have a couple minutes left, but I do want to touch on one last issue.
Yes.
There was a play that was left out that Charles Isherwood of the New York Times has got his little knickers all twisted up over. The Realistic Joneses, which in my reporting with the Tony nominators, they loathe that play. They loathe it, and they loathe it even more because the New York Times seemed to try to ram it down their throat. Was this play that my good friend Charles Isherwood has hailed as a contemporary masterpiece? Is Charles just by himself on this one, Jesse? Is he going nuts?
But he doesn't have me with him. It's a fascinating thing when you fly up to becoming a critic. Your opinions that really meant nothing before, well, they still mean nothing, but you suddenly see that everyone has different taste. It's terrifying. He was a champion of this playwright and
Will
of
Eno,
this play.
Years,
I didn't really care for the play, and apparently a lot of other people didn't either, although it was a beautiful production.
Yeah. What did you think of this
play? I thought it was terrific, and I agree that they should welcome challenging stuff, not just nice, nice stuff. However, I think perhaps the extreme praise that was foisted on people may have turned some people off, and it may have backfired against the play.
Yeah. I kind of like this because I think people really rebel against the Times. They're not afraid of the New York Times anymore. They don't respect what the New York Times critics have to say. I scoop Pat Healy on a regular basis. I mean, are we seeing the total diminishment of the New York Times on Broadway now, Patrick?
But I agree with Michael that I think it is the role of a mainstream critic to champion a play like The Realistic Joneses. I mean, I'm sure Waiting
Well, if he likes it.
Yeah, and I think that Waiting for Godot never won a Tony Award until it was revived in 2009.
They had a Carole King song.
I got the sense from seeing The Realistic Joneses that the actors had a sense, oh, this is art. It was sort of an attitude that they had, that this very existential dialogue, and a lot of it was funny. I was writing it down.
I felt that way about Aladdin, too, I think the actors.
Yes, it was sort of a polar opposite of Aladdin. Right. But, you know, that I got this a sense of it that might have been a turnoff to people.
I don't think it was pretentious. And I think the director, Sam Gold, did a good job with a very challenging play. And I think that it
deserves to be all you need to know about that. All you need to know about that play is, you know what the last line is? I like mint.
Well, you have to see it.
Oh, it's so profound, Michael.
I am, George. I am.
Bravo.
I am mint.
Bravo. All right, that's it. So thanks, you guys, for your
Bravo.
I'm Jesse Green from New York Magazine, Michael Musto from Out.com, and Patrick Pacheco from, God, there's too long, too many trails behind your name. New York One, LA Times.
Artinfo.com.
Artinfo.com. Thanks for being our guest tonight on Theater Talk.
You just think, oh my God, you know, I'd like to run a theater where I can show these plays to people.
Our thanks to the Friends of Theater Talk for their significant contribution to this production. Theater Talk is made possible in part by the Frederick Lowe Foundation, the Corey and Bob Dinelli Charitable Fund, the Noel Coward Foundation, Carrie J. Fries, the Dorothy Strelson Foundation, plus public funds from the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs, the New York State Council on the Arts, a state agency, and the Theater Development Fund's Technical Accessibility Program, which helps provide closed captioning.
We welcome your questions or comments for Theater Talk. Thank you and good night.